Mikey with you in the Collective Arts Black Box Studio with the whole SETI, Craig and Tatter here. Hey, guys.
Hey.
How you doing?
Good. Thanks for having us. Great.
And congratulations on 10 years as a band.
Thank you. It's 11, actually.
Really?
We just celebrated at 10 and 11.
Well, 10 years since the first record.
Yeah. Yeah, at least.
And I think with the new record, Teeth Dreams Out, I think the transformation is complete from whatever mock the last one was. Going through the 2010 record, this one is great record, big, complete sound. But let's start with the drum sound, because I got taken aback. I put the record on, and it sounded like an avalanche. A bit 80s, but that big drum sound on this record.
Yeah, that's Nick. When Nick Raskolnikov, the producer, came up to do some pre-production with us in Brooklyn, Bobby was playing this old Gretsch kit that he has that he actually traded. There was some kind of, Bobby's a mechanic, and he traded a car for it years ago, and he had it. And Nick really wanted him to play that, so we sent that down with some other stuff to Nashville, where we recorded, and I don't think he ever touched it. They didn't tune the drums, they didn't change the heads, they didn't do anything. He just set it up and put mics on it, and it sounds pretty fantastic. And part of that is the SSL, too, with just that high mid-range and stuff like that. It sounds awesome.
And yeah, the record starts off with, you know, some classic Great Old SETI tunes. But the one I wanted to talk about, where the record changes, is the Ambassador. It really changes the mood of the record there.
Yeah, and funny enough, that was one of the earliest songs we had, but it's certainly a slow one and kind of a one that breathes a little bit. And but yeah, that was the one that came together quickly for us, which is usually a good sign that it's going to make the record.
And then one of the most delightful little is from a melodic standpoint is Big Sig. Talk about that song.
Big Sig is kind of inspired by this kid I know who's, when I was in high school, I started smoking cigarettes and made the mistake of buying the big ones because he thought that they would more for your money, I guess, and immediately they looked ridiculous. And I've always thought about him trying to look cool while smoking a big long cigarette. He also had really big feet, so it was like kind of a bad look for him. So I always thought humorous about those big cigs, and for some reason that just kind of clicked when I heard the music.
And then to end the record is I'm not a long song fan, but. This one I don't mind. This one, you know, you can really get into some deep thoughts. Just talk about how did Oaks come together. It's like an eight minute sprawling rock classic.
Well, the first part, you know, kind of existed on its own for a while, and we were kind of rehearsing it that way. And then Craig said, you know, like we need something. We need another part on the end, which is a common occurrence with Hold Steady songs, is we always kind of like, oh, let's put this other part on the end of it. So, you know, immediately we were like, wow, God, we're doing that again. But it needed a scene change that was something that was a little more hopeful.
Yeah, it became obvious that it was going to be the last song on the record, and kind of wanted to leave it on a little more hopeful note, so we added that coda, and right, then that goes out. A 9-minute song as a radio guy, yeah, that's probably not your best friend.
How did your record in between, the solo record that came out with the Friday Night Lights title, Clear Eyes, Full Heart, what did you get out of your system in doing that record?
Doing something quiet, you know, I mean, and you know, being just pretty much only the vocalist, lyricist in this band, you know, so like, you know, doing all the touring, the big kind of huge rock, and not, you know, just like being physically kind of drained of singing loud and not always feeling like you're getting through. So it was fun to go make a quiet record where the stories really came through and tour on it where you knew, like, you know, you could hear a pin drop, that kind of thing, for when you're doing the quiet stuff. But at the same time, it got it out of my system. After 10 years in the Hold Steady, I'm not sure I feel validation unless someone's throwing a beer up in the air. So I kind of was like, now that that's out, I got excited to make a big rock record.
Now, talking about throwing a beer and having a good time, we last saw you, it was last July. It was our Turf Toronto Urban Roots Festival, happening again July 4th to 6th. But one of the funniest moments in rock, you guys are doing Stay Positive. Frank Turner comes out, he's going away at the choruses. And then what? One of the roadies comes and drags him off.
It was our sound man / tour manager who hadn't worked for us for long, and he didn't know Frank. And he was just zealously doing a good job. He actually came from behind the soundboard to do that.
Because he thought it was just a fan who jumped
out.
He
thought it was a guy, and, you know, we've kind of had some scary things before, so we don't always like people on stage, but right, we had most certainly invited Frank to sing on the song, and there was a big misunderstanding, which kind of made it all the funnier and all the better
in some way. And it was watching it. Like, I mean, okay, a guy gets up and sings from the crowd. Well, either the band's body language or security, yeah, that would have been on the side of the stage, but we were well in three quarters of the way through the song, yeah. And you guys were, everyone smiling and laughing.
I think testament that Frank, to Frank being a great guy, that he took it very well.
Let's talk about, we found out, the whole world did, that you're Seth Meyers' all-time favorite band. You appeared on the second week of the show. Did you know that already when you were booked, or that he was a big fan? How did that whole experience of being on the new show work out?
Well, he got in touch with us quite a few months earlier.
Yeah.
When they were looking for a band to do the theme song for The Awesomes, which is the Hulu cartoon that they did. So, you know, we kind of started to correspond or keep in touch with him then. Craig knew him before. I'd never met him until then. But since then, we've kind of kept in touch, and it was bizarre getting, you know, an email from him the night before we're about to go do a show, being like, I'm so psyched you guys are doing my show. And it just, like, that's kind of mind blowing.
Yeah, because you never know. Like, I remember Jon Stewart's old show he had on MTV, and his last show, he had Buffalo Tom on. They were his favorite band.
Anything you do with television just proves to you how small music is. You know, I mean, like, you're on TV and anything, and it seems like your phone starts ringing off the hook.
Well, last year was also the Replacements reunion, and we know how much that touched all of us. Did you get to see the show?
I got to see him in Chicago, yeah. And even better, I watched at least the first 10 songs on the side of the stage standing next to Bob Mould.
Yeah.
And as a guy who grew up in Minneapolis, that was like, you know, standing next to one hero watching another. It was pretty cool. One point Bob said, can you believe we're watching this? And I said, Bob, I can't believe any of this.
And speaking of Bob, he's hit a renaissance again. His new records are great, but he's found the loud again.
I'm really happy. I mean, his shows are fantastic recently, and he's got a really good band, and Jason Arducci and John Worster, and they just seem to be clicking, and he seems to be really inspired. And you know, in the past few years, we did a tribute thing out in L.A. with him and got to know him a little bit. And that's been really cool because he's been really supportive of the band, which means a ton to me.
Totally. And, you know, the Minneapolis Star Tribune got behind the... I don't know if it was just a guy who was working there, but they really did a good job of covering the Replacements. Have they... Has the city really embraced and knowing everything that's gone on in the last 20 years or 30 years now? But, you know, if you want to start with the Husker Du and Replacements, but, you know, through Soul Asylum and the Jayhawks and you guys, has it been embraced and is part of the fabric and the culture of the city the way Mary Tyler Moore is, you think?
I think so. I mean, the one thing that's interesting about Minneapolis is they really do. I mean, it's so geographically removed from everywhere else that they really do support local music in a way that's very unique. I mean, there's bands that can sell out First Avenue that can't get a gig in Milwaukee, you know.
That might be
an exaggeration, but you know, I think it's supportive to an insane degree. It's part of what the city is.
Record Store Day is coming up on Saturday. Which one of you guys worked in the record store? Every band has to have one.
I never did.
Really?
Oh, yeah. I don't think I worked in a guitar store, but never a record store.
Okay, that's close enough.
All right.
Now, last year you had the Game of Thrones just started this year, so last year you had the single to it, and that came out. Anything Record Store Day this year?
Not until maybe the one in November. Okay. This one that was too close to the record, we had our hands full.
Right, yeah. All right, the Hold Steady, always rocking it, and stay positive.
Stay positive.
Thank you.
Never let them tie you up. It's a big city that's a lot of love. Salted rims and frosted mugs. You gotta get back out there. Light champagne and empty.